Happy Halloween! And welcome to our Halloween Imp Extra. Hello and welcome to the Bottled Imp. This is a Halloween Imp Extra. My name is Ken Boyter and this fine fellow is Julian. And together we are the Bottled Imp. And you know what? We do explore the realms of fantasy. And this time though, we're going to do something slightly different. We will be watching a film and then chatting about it. But there is a twist. As it's Halloween, what's happening?
Well, we're going to watch a horror film.
What?
Which is fantasy.
It
not
is fantasy.
Necessarily the fantasy we cover as such.
Yeah,
kind
yeah.
of it's that area. But it's fantasy nonetheless.
Yeah, and I don't really watch horror films.
So, we thought a good idea if I choose the horror films to watch.
Yeah.
So I have a bag of death.
The bag
here.
Of death. No expense
and
spared on that bag.
Here's
of death.
What I thought we'd attempt to do. This is subject to change when we realise we haven't got the time.
Yes.
But let's see how we get on. What I thought.
I've no idea what.
And I meant to do a bit more research on this.
Okay.
Okay. Is we'd start off by watching the classic film.
Oh.
The Evil Dead. Have you seen it?
I've not seen it.
Okay, The Evil
I've
Dead, the
it.
Original Evil Dead, directed by and written by Sam Raimi.
Right.
This is a classic film, and I meant to actually get the date it was made, but we'll talk more about it
it's
later.
It's already freaked me out because there's a picture of a guy with a chainsaw on
there's
the back.
There's a chainsaw on the back, yes.
Yeah.
This is, and we will talk more about this later,
yeah.
but Evil Dead is a classic. It's the film that kind of pretty much started all the horror. Well, no, it didn't.
Well,
there
it's
there
slasher,
are films.
Isn't it?
It's kind of that slasher genre. It's kind of tongue-in-cheek a bit, but it's a groundbreaking, low-budget film. I mean, he made this with his mates for a small amount of money, and it just blew out of all proportions.
Yeah. My brother had I think he had nightmares for about 2 weeks.
Did he? It's really... Oh, well, I don't know. It depends. I don't think it's... I was brought up watching
I might
films.
Be doing images.
But it's... I thought, let's watch this, because this is going old school. Then I had the idea, if we're watching that, we should probably then go straight into watching Evil Dead 2, the sequel, which again was, unlike a lot of sequels, Sam Raimi and the sort of same team that went to make it. When that was such a success, I think they went back and they had some money and they made some. See, I should have got the facts.
Yeah, we'll get the facts.
We'll get the facts in the chat afterwards. Then I thought, we're watching this.
Of course.
What? Do we have time? We should probably watch Bruce Campbell versus the Army of Darkness, which is the third installment of the Evil Dead trilogy.
Right.
This is really hard to get hold of. I don't even think you can buy it now. This is called the official bootleg edition, and it's director's cut, and it's all... I looked online, you can't even get this, I don't think, anymore. And this is an American DVD, so I had to make sure my DVD player could play it, because here in England,
there's
different regions. And it does. So. In theory, if we can get through three, I thought that would be a day of Halloween.
You know, yeah, definitely Halloween-esque type film to watch. I've not seen any of them, and purposely done so because I'm not very good with horror films.
So this is what I thought would be fun about this.
Mm.
So we'll either be just talking about this, or we'll be trying to get through all three of these. They're not massively long films.
We could do maybe part two and part three, maybe.
Maybe, but wouldn't it be good to do a day?
Yes.
And see what happens.
So really blow my mind.
What we'll do is we will go and watch things and come back. Probably not here, because we're not actually allowed to film here.
No.
And we'll talk about one, two, or maybe even all three of these.
Yes.
If Ken is not
He's still
too
alive.
Queasy.
Not been throwing up. There we go. Well, thank you. Yes, excellent. That does look brilliant.
And you should watch. You know,
well, at least the first
you should
one.
At least need to.
Yeah, I guess if you're into films, you need to watch certain classics, even if they're not the sort of total genre that you really normally are into.
No.
So we're going to see you on the other side.
She's your girlfriend, you take care of her.
Whoa. Oh, okay. I need a bit of a drink first before we go anywhere.
That was full on.
What do you make of it? So we did.
We
just
did three.
Got through Evil Dead.
Yep.
Evil Dead 2.
Yep.
Dead by Dawn.
Death by Chocolate.
Dead by watching Evil Dead movie. Yeah. And then we did manage to squeeze in the official bootleg edition of Bruce Campbell version versus the Army of Darkness, the director's cut.
We'll get back to the strange title of that in a minute. But yeah, so I've never, as we've just said, I've never seen these films. You've seen them, but you've seen probably the first one more than the others.
I've seen this a fair few times.
Yeah.
And then I obviously, back in the day when I was really into the sort of filmmaking thing and kind of buying these, because this was a well-famous, low-budget, you know, Sam Raimi's first sort of break into the movie industry by making this film. So yeah, then bought these others to sort of study them.
Yeah. So we looked at the first one was 1982.
Right.
Second one was 1987 or 8, I think. Can't remember off the top of the head. And then the last one was 1993.
Right.
So it's quite, it spans 10 years of filmmaking. And obviously films come along, horror genre moves along. My first question is then, what do you have got it written down?
To the audience.
I made notes. No,
to
you.
I'm no expert.
Well, no, we're talking about horror. Well, what? Okay, you're more into horror than I am. I've got a certain sort of liking what I want to see in fantasy films.
Yeah.
You must have like a, what's the tick list then in horror films? So for you, did it do what you wanted it to do as a horror film? Well, the first one, I guess.
Well, it's, you see, I never, this, the problem with this is I'm not, I wouldn't call myself a horror fan as such. I probably was brought up as a young guy, teenager, watching, going to the video shop, renting video nasties.
I thought you were brought up as an old guy.
I was brought up as an old guy. So I got into horror as a young guy, like a lot of people do. And when I was young, you didn't have certificates like 18 stuff. You could just go to the video shop and hire any horror film.
Sure.
Then the 80s or something came along, and Mary Whitehouse came along, and horror films were banned, and they were cast as video nasties, and the Driller Killers and the Damaged Brains and stuff were banned. And I got in before that and sort of watched these films. And they were very, the horror genre was full on gore slash prosthetics, you know, all obviously back then, real blood, no CGI, there's no CGI back then. So it was all models and it was all makeup.
Yeah,
and that's what's my fascination with it, I think.
See,
I was interested in the stuff.
You're interested in that side of it. That's the sort of thing that puts me off this sort of stuff. But I might have done this sort of stuff a lot of good, a disservice, because I'm thinking I want character and I want plot.
Well, I think,
so,
absolutely. I didn't watch these because I just, I think as a youngster you want them for gore and stuff. As a youngster you're not going, I'm a real film buff, I want character and plot.
I
learned as I got older, I think, and got more into filmmaking and reading books about screenwriting and things like that.
I guess so, yeah.
The mechanics and the nuts and bolts of how you make a good film and the structure. But back then when you're a kid you're just wanting some action. Like you'd love to go and see a Terminator movie because you just want some action. You're not going, I want some good character and plot. Obviously what makes the film more enjoyable is good acting and good plot. But actually, you want to see the Mercury Man melt onto the lawn, do all that sort of stuff. You know, there's that, isn't it? So I didn't watch horror films. I mean, I didn't buy, when I bought these, I didn't buy these because I was a big horror film fan. I bought these because I was a wannabe filmmaker I wanted to learn from watching this.
Yeah.
And this was a very famous cult low-budget film.
Yeah.
Low budget, it was $150,000, which is very low budget for a film shot on film.
Yeah.
This was 16mm. So it was to see how they made this, and there's a book that goes, you know, there's a book about the making of this film and about, you know, all the tricks they did. So that's why I enjoyed these films. So I'm not watching them as a horror fan, I'm watching them as a filmmaker.
That said,
so I don't know much about horror.
Well, the thing is, I remember growing up, and you've got these video nasties, so I kind of put video nasty and horror together.
Mm.
Like fantasy, though, there's various different genres of horror. So you've got, you know, there's the more supernatural kind of thriller, build up the tension, as opposed to out and out, like slasher films. So I was kind of surprised that it did spend, the first one, I've got a cold, I'm sorry. The first one, I've been possessed.
Don't you give me your possession of a cold.
Exactly. The first one, I thought I was surprised because it spent at least 40 minutes setting things up. And I think what I enjoyed with the first one, because it wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be. I thought it was going to be really terrible.
Bad as in
crappy as in film, a crappy film, or bad as in...
Yeah, well, both. Yeah. As in crappy film, you know, crappy...
Well, no, it hasn't become a massively cult movie because it was a crappy film. It's actually a very good film, and if you put it in context of when it was, it's been very, very copied since then.
Yeah, yeah.
So this was one of the first ones to sort of do the cabin in the woods, kids going to the cabin and woods being picked off type thing.
But what I liked about it, it did have a certain style to the direction. So, for example, the opening shot, there's that... sort of the camera's drifting over the lake and it looks a bit eerie, as though that's like a ghost, you know, because it's very smooth, and then it goes into the woods in a very smooth sort of shot, so it already seems, oh, it's got a bit of style to this.
Certainly.
It, you know, it's because I think there's a difference between, you could just go, right, let's do a horror, you know, slasher film that doesn't have directorial vision.
Yeah,
this has certainly got vision to it.
Definitely. So, and hence this, you know, Sam Raimi's career taking off and being a very successful filmmaker now.
Yeah,
you know, he obviously had he had an eye and a sense of
and he could build up
filmmaking.
I mean, it is interesting. Again, we were saying earlier when we were sort of talking about it, kind of during the film, really, about, do you watch a film out of context and say, no, I'm gonna, this is just the film on its own? Can you enjoy a film like that? Or is it, should you always sort of forgive it and say, well, back then technology wasn't as good, back then, I don't know, I like to think, no, it's got to stand up still on its own merits. And I think the first one especially did, simply because of the directorial vision. He kept it interesting with the different angles, the different shots, and the different ideas. He had a lot of different ideas, because come on, let's face it, there was five friends, and they, you know, presumably people know the plot really, and they all get possessed, but it's how they get possessed, because you've got to come up with more imaginative ways each time, haven't you? And you've got to keep it going. So if you're building layer upon layer of action, it's almost like that one-upmanship, isn't it?
Yeah, well, I think so. I mean, ultimately, the film is people trapped in a wood stroke cabin, being terrorised by some force.
Yeah, so how do you keep that going?
And it's basically just a vehicle for having lots of people being monsters mutilated. And chopped up and mutilated and stuff like that, isn't it?
Yeah.
And so, yeah, that's what you've got. It's not a long film, what is it, an hour and 20 minutes? But, you know, that's enough if you've just got people stuck there. There's no greater depth of plot than that, necessarily. That's the thing, you know. There's a little journey for the lead character, the Bruce Campbell character, Ash, who starts off a little bit timid and ends up, certainly by the end of this, some massive great action movie. And this had a much bigger budget, so they really push it and find their feet with it. But
it was completely bizarre in some respects how far his character did travel. And remember, they all follow on directly after each other. Yeah. So from the first and second, he's had a rough couple of days,
hasn't
he?
He's seen
a lot of things. Yeah. And... That's what I was going to say. He's the only one that does have a story arc. And it was interesting because, for me, where it really clicked in the first one was when he did decide to go, you know what, I can't just sit back and let this happen. I need to now come forward and do stuff I don't really want to do by attacking people that I once loved because they're possessed. That, to me, that's when it clicked. That was then, right, okay, now he's got a motivation, now he's got, there's an actual story, you know, character development. The others didn't really. And the thing I do struggle with this sort of plot is about characterization, because we didn't really know anything about the people. So I'm not connected to them, and therefore when they sort of get possessed in that, I'm like, well, okay, fair enough. Yeah, I don't really care enough for you to really worry about.
And I think modern films, and again, this is the thing, this film, when did you say this was made? This is, what, 92, did we say?
No, the first one was 82.
82. Yeah, so we're talking many years ago, and this is the thing again about how screenwriting has got so much more sophisticated, and people have realised that you engage in the characters more, you get more, you learn
like
to love
Shaun of the Dead.
So this was, and this was also a bunch of guys who got together and raised some money and made a film,
friends,
and so they're learning their craft by making this, and so learning screenwriting as well. So yes, it didn't have, it was, let's make a horror film, let's put some gore in it, let's find creative, cheap ways to make blood spewing out of things, you know, and it could have worked from a bit more backstory and characters, a bit more stuff, but that was when that was made, and that was how it's made. And I'm sure the stuff Sam Raimi's written or directed now are much more sophisticated.
Oh, yeah, I can totally agree with that. So, but again, this is where it does then come back in context. if you are just strict and go, no, I don't care when it was made, it's got to stand up on its own 2 feet, then I think it's a solid enough film because of the vision for you to, for it to sort of warrant its critical acclaim.
Yeah.
Do you see what I mean?
Yeah.
As opposed to, if it, you know, because it still stood up, even though it had sort of various flaws within the storyline, and can you really get connected to the characters? In a way, it's bizarre, because then you start almost, you then, I guess where you're, if you're that way inclined, because it's just struck me, you then actually become, right, we all know they're going to die, or at least one of them's going to survive, but all of them are going to die. How are they going to die? And that then becomes the enjoyment.
Yeah.
How can I be, how can I, you know, how can I see the gore? How does that head get chopped off? Who's the next one?
Mm.
I guess that becomes the fun of watching these sort of films.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, they're one big action sequence, aren't they? One big, you know, once you get into the swing of it, it's just one long list of different things, of hands being chopped off, or someone being hit by something, or a chainsaw chopping a monster into bits, or whatever. Yeah. And it that can become relentless, and you watch the second one, and it's basically a continuation. It's another hour and 20, hour and a half of more of that.
Yeah.
And if you love that sort of stuff, great. And I think as a teenager, you said, you know, you're loving that sort of stuff.
Well, the second one...
I enjoyed them, but I must admit, sitting watching them, I mean, I've seen them before as
well.
So it's like, it's still fun.
The
but
second one is certainly more relentless, because the first one, I think they
you
did
have a bit of build up, but don't
yeah, they had a bit of build up, and I think they did genuinely want to do like a serious horror film, because it's very minimal in any comedy, in any laughs, any funny lines, or even any corny lines, like, you know, you might snap an arm off and go, yeah, I told you he was armless, you know.
Yeah, it didn't have any jokes. There were
it was just
much
pure
higher standard than that joke just then.
Well, I don't know.
Quite,
I don't know.
That wasn't in there.
No, that's what I'm saying. But by the third one, you had how many bone references for the skeletons?
Yeah,
it was. It then became a parody, and it's interesting because then when I did do, I you know when we set up, I had a quick look of the sequel, the second one. It was specifically meant to be a parody of the first one.
Yeah, I
so
think they've found
became,
that they could then they go down the slightly spoofier comedy aspect.
Yeah.
Not necessarily jokes and stuff, but more kind of eyes flying through
out
the air.
There,
flying to somebody's mouth, a bit more sort of silly.
Yeah, and more slapstick.
Yeah, a bit more slapstick. Oh yeah, with all the hand stuff. Slapstick
And there was a lot of homage to other films as well, because you had, with the splat stick, as I read, good old Wikipedia, I reckon, it said that they were kind of influenced by the Three Stooges.
Yeah.
They put that in. From our own British point of view, I kind of thought, oh, it's almost like Carry On, you know, Haunted House of Horrors or Hammer House of Horror type things. What else have I put here? That's the third one. Yeah, the third one's really influenced by a lot of them, a lot of other different films. But with this one, the second one was kind of almost a remake because it was still in the cabin. But I read that they wanted to get them out of the cabin, but they didn't have the budget, so they basically did a remake.
Yeah,
and they
just
did
with a bit more money and a few more people.
And that would explain the continuity, not error, but the continuity decision where the friends weren't involved in the second one, like the bodies weren't lying around the cabin or anything like that.
Right.
So that it was purely because I read that it purely just said, no, the budget wouldn't allow it, so they just had to strip it back to him and his girlfriend being there, and that was kind of it. Which I guess is fair enough. It makes sense in a film on its own. I mean,
but it was interesting that they even did that, because they could have just started from where the first one ended and not have the girlfriend, just him there, and then the other people join, which is ultimately what happened.
Yeah, exactly.
The new people join.
Yeah.
Keeping an eye on the time, because the camera.
Yeah. But with the second one, again, I thought you could tell they were more experienced filmmakers, because there was more kind of, the budget was bigger.
Mm.
But they handled the special effects well. I think they come up with more inventive things. We just kind of thought, especially by the third one, it was like, right, let's brainstorm this. Any idea
is in. Everything was chucked.
Yeah.
Put everything out there and let's include it.
Yeah. There's no ideas we're not going to do. Because it just became, not sillier and sillier, but there were more elements of slapstick creeping in. And it, as far as gore, there was a few things, and I'm not brilliant with the gore, where I had to do that. But that's more to do with gore rather than making me jump. There was at no point was I scared, and at no point was I
I guess, believing what was going on.
No, and again, that's to do with the sophistication of the audience we are now, yeah, I think. Yeah, I think maybe back then, when you watched these films, they were a bit more scary. They had the jumps, but a lot of the stuff we're so used to now, the fake climax leading to the sudden real climax, we know this is going to happen.
Yeah.
And I've seen more than you, so I'm probably more hardened to it, but you're still aware of the suspense, how you build up suspense.
Yeah.
And it's quite hard now, I think, in a film to actually get you sucked in so much that you're actually scared, and certainly in something as crazy and over the top of this, you're never going to be really so sucked in, are you?
Yeah. It gets more action-y, doesn't it? It's more like a full-on action
film. Third one?
Well, the second one, it starts it, because it's when he gets the chainsaw and he puts, you know, his hands gets chopped off. Puts the chainsaw, and that becomes then an action. And I just thought, oh, this is Terminator.
Right.
It became very Terminator and Mad Maxy. Mad Maxy.
The third one felt a bit like that because it was suddenly out in the whole different location.
Yeah.
You know, and that was a bit more that sort of feel.
Yeah.
But, the second we were still in the wood, weren't we? And still in the cabin. So.
I think two things there because he became more of an action hero, because he was like, right, I now know what I've done. I've just gone through one night of hell on the first one, and I've had to fight my way, and I've survived, and then, oh my God, they've got me again. He is just out and out. He's not afraid anymore, sort of thing. Mm. He just goes, right, now I know I need to just slaughter everybody. And he goes looking for the hacksaw, doesn't he, the chainsaw again.
Yeah.
He goes looking for the shotgun. He actually goes, right, I need to tool up. And he, you know, I guess, spoilers, but he has to saw his own hand off because it becomes possessed. That was a slapsticky bit, wasn't it? That's when it started getting a bit slapstick with the plates.
Yeah.
The plate scene when he's smashing the plates on his head. But he then went, and that's when it almost became, I think that's probably where it became iconic, because he had the chainsaw on his knob. I'm not quite sure how he managed to.
Did he put it on his knob, or did he put it on the stump of his severed hand?
Yeah, that's what I mean.
I see what you mean.
Hey, I see what he did there.
Yeah.
Very good. Hey, what do you think of that? stunned. Yes, he put it on the severed hand, and then it's only just occurred. How does he work a chainsaw with just a nut? How does that turn that on and off?
Well, it's always on, isn't it? Once you start a chainsaw, it's going. And that's why chainsaws are lethally dangerous.
But at one point, he just went, and he kind of started up.
No, he did it. You see him rig it up with his mouth and he pulls it. I don't. You can never start a chainsaw with your teeth pulling
I think he did.
He started up at the beginning of that.
Yeah.
And then we just brush over that. Because, like, you know.
Well, there's a lot of things that you kind of have to start brushing over, don't you?
Well, yeah. It's a crazy, over-the-top horror film. You pretty much leave your reality and you know, load up your suspension of disbelief.
Yeah, maybe I do struggle with that a bit as a viewer, because even in fantasy, I still want things to make sense.
But you're the man who can't watch a musical because you can't get over the fact that people break into song.
No, but I tricked myself into doing it. I watched La La Land and I went, oh, if I pretend that when they start singing, that's actually in their imagination. Yeah.
You have
really
to do that
it.
In order to watch a musical, rather than just suspension of disbelief. Yeah. It's a movie, let's just enjoy it and watch it.
I enjoyed it then, because I could understand the context of the magical world.
It's a little insight into Ken's pain.
Yeah, nobody wants to go there. But what I was going to say was, so for example, you know, especially in fantasy, you have to set up the rules, because they have to make sense, because otherwise it doesn't. As it, oh, didn't it? So I have that very well. But for example, I really loathe the bit in Lord of the Rings where Orlando Bloom's character, the elf, what's his name? Legolas, the Lego man. There are big battles raging around and they're fighting, you know, and he's got his bow and arrow and he's like a top marksman with it. And then he gets a shield and just surfs down the steps.
Right.
Just surfs down it on a shield.
Can you not do that?
I doubt you can do it in real life.
See, that to me is something that's probably quite plausible. Yeah. Maybe you get enough momentum and whoosh down the step on a shield. Is that not going to slide down?
This is a challenge. We ought to do it.
It's a flat bit of metal.
No, it was a... Yeah, but the stairs, they're... You know,
I mean, probably they exaggerate. Yeah, it's probably the way he did it. It's probably you would have had to practice that, you know, many, many times. But I don't know the bit you're talking about. But actually, that's not like in Lord of the Rings, where lots of magical crazy shit happens. The bit that stumps you is a guy sliding down some steps, which is a hill ultimately, on a flat surface.
No, but the reason why is that if you've got magic, you set the rules up for magic.
But that might not be magic. That might just be someone...
No, but that's what I'm saying. Because that isn't magic, then that's meant to be reality.
Have you ever bumped down the stairs of your house on a pillow or a duvet or sort of created a slide?
But not on a... Yeah, I did actually. But not on a... Not on a shield. I don't think that... It just felt unrealistic to me. Okay. That's what I'm saying.
In Lord of the Rings. Got,
No, but you're missing the point. If that is meant to be gravity and that bit, forget, because that no magic was involved, unless there was, but it wasn't very clear then to the audience that magic was involved, that he could do
maybe
that.
Maybe he was just a really good skateboarder.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It just didn't
look
realistic.
And that was skateboarding
realistic.
Of that... I've not seen... I can't remember.
Yeah, but what I'm trying to say is that, for example, you know, we're sitting here, this is meant to be reality, we're talking about reality, and then suddenly my book floats up there. Mm. That's going to, you know, it's like, that. Where's the context of that? We needed to sort of set that up.
Well, that'd be like, wow, holy shit, your book's floating, suddenly we're into the world of magic.
Yeah,
the thing is, in these kind of films, anything goes.
It's not
a zombie film, therefore, the bit about him being scratched, he didn't turn into a thing. It's just shit's happening,
No, it's possession, that one, is supernatural.
Yeah.
But so, I still think...
And that's a much more grey area possession than a zombie. If you get bitten by a zombie, you tend to turn to a zombie. If you get bitten by a vampire, you get turned to a vampire. They're the sort of rules of those creatures. Possession, what are the rules of possession? I don't know.
Well, this is it.
It's a bit more airy-fairy.
Okay, my other point was that... And I know this is why we have to get, you know, continuity and all of that. There was a bit where that copious amount of blood comes out of the cellar.
And then she's not. Now,
she's not caked in it at all.
Yeah, now... I can let that go because the whole film's so ridiculously over the top.
Yeah.
It kind of doesn't even matter. That's the least of the issues.
I know, but for me that breaks
but
the
that,
magic.
But that possibly would have been a continuity error in the thing, but quite a major one.
Yeah,
Or just a... Yeah, she should have been damper and more red. Mm. But, you know...
it's
but
just
the
those
film
little
is so
things.
Insanely ridiculous.
I know.
It doesn't... That's just...
I think this is where... So, again, it's maybe also to do with people's viewing, what you bring to a film. Because I'm like thinking, right, I genuinely thought that Evil Dead was a proper horror film, which it is, the first one definitely is.
Yeah.
And so I kind of wanted ultimate believability. Now again, that could just be the way that films were made back then, and the more sophisticated.
Why is a horror film need ultimate believability as a horror film?
No, everything does, doesn't it? So for example, if you're watching a normal drama, even something like EastEnders, you know, a soap,
But that's a realistic sort of flood war type thing. Whereas fantasy.
No, but everything. But you still can't break the sort of fourth dimension. So, for example, in EastEnders, if the acting's not very good, it doesn't become believable. Or you do, you know, a character does something that you think, well, that doesn't. Or for example, you know, I don't know how to describe it. But so, for example. Something you know doesn't actually happen in real life, and it's in EastEnders, and it happens. Not something supernatural, but something just ordinary, like, you know, you pick up a phone and it's the wrong dialing tone. You know, it's like it's an American ring. You know, like I don't know how to describe it. Like a doorbell, and you press the doorbell, and it's meant to be EastEnders, and it's meant to go ding dong, and it goes rarara, rarara. You'd think, well, that's a bit doesn't happen in real life.
Unless the family are a bit kooky or crazy and you go into the house. But
you see what I mean? It's that kind of... Well, you can't break...
I think in an episode of EastEnders, if something magical happened, you'd go, what's going on here?
Mm.
But in a,
I don't mean
in a fantasy movie or any kind of horror movie or stuff, I think it's open to stuff, isn't it? And again, it depends. It depends what it is. Like you say, in the world of Lord of the Rings, presumably you can't have a flying saucer suddenly land and Star Trek start happening.
Yes, because that's what I mean. Because you're not set it up.
Yeah,
that's not
what that film is.
Yeah.
This kind of film is open to much more craziness, but still within the realms of that genre. I'm not...
And also, it's interesting, the development of the three films, because they didn't plan it to be a trilogy right from the beginning... Mm. You know, it's a unexpected success, so they think, right, well, okay, let's do
where
a second one.
This,
where we're going to take this. So you then might think, let's try it and explore something, and then think, well, you know what, we're not going to be trapped in one genre. Let's do it a bit more spoofy. Let's do it a bit more comedic. And then certainly by the third one, because at the end of the second one, what happens?
God, I can't even remember. We've been watching
it's
it all
day. It's
through a
traveling.
Time portal. Yeah, the third one is so...
Yeah.
So different.
They go back to the 13th century for the Army of Darkness, which is, again, totally unexpected, because it's like, oh, okay, this isn't traditional horror. And that's what I mean. I guess your fantasy, because you're not massively into fantasy as such, your expectation of a fantasy film is more like Lord of the Rings, whereas exactly my horror is more like Evil Dead, the original one, or, you know, Dawn of the Dead, or Texas Chainsaw Massacre. But there's more subtleties within the horror genre, isn't there? Just like there is in fantasy.
Well, yeah, it's. I think it's a very, very wide open genre, and there's suspense, and there's slasher, and there's blatant just gore slash fest craziness.
And there's supernatural.
And there's clever, sophisticated sort of horrors. And more nowadays, when the horror genre's really come back, hasn't there? And they're either trying to come out with clever things. It's very hard to create a horror because a lot of it's been done and you're just copying, and it's just, you know.
But like the Blair Witch Project, I'd say that's horror, but it's not.
I think
gore,
that, and I think that reinvented a genre in a way thriller. Because that was a whole new thing with the whole filming it themselves and making it very realistic almost. Yeah. And is this real? And the whole marketing campaign they did for that in America when it was all like internet viral marketed and no one really knew what was going on with this film. So that was a very clever. That was reinventing a genre that was so tired and dated.
But it wasn't. But it wasn't out and out gore. As far as
that wasn't. That was more your suspense trying to really build the frights up, wasn't it? There was no real gore in it. Yeah. It would just really mess with your mind a bit, you know. Mm.
So it's interesting why they then went, you know what, let's go back to the medieval time.
But I think that's the journey of this film and the director. I think you've got to take these in the context that they are, as we said, as some guys got together, said, let's make a film and raise some money, and they made this film. Became a cult success or something, so they got studios interested and got a load of money to make this film, and then they went on a crazy thing. How much did this film cost? They
11 million.
So they went from $150,000 to $11 million budget. So as new filmmakers going, right, you know, we've been given $11 million.
Successful.
You're going to have loads of extras. You're suddenly going to... We filmed in a cabin the last two films. Let's go to... whatever century it was.
They had a nightmare film as well. I read up on that.
Right.
Because it was, all on location. They didn't build the cabin.
No.
And it was
the second one or the third?
The first one.
The first one.
First one, they didn't build the set. That was a proper on location set. And people had injuries.
Yeah. They didn't know what they were doing and they were just winging it.
I think they had running water, but it wasn't brilliant.
Yeah.
You know, it was very, very basic. And so
there's a great book about the making of it, if you're into filmmaking. I should have had a little look through it. But,
So it was...
Well, I think they recreated the cam for the second one because they had a bigger budget then, didn't they? I know there's something.
Probably. Because they needed to...
Yeah.
But also in the third one, it does become...
We need to wrap this up to running out of time.
Well, I was just going to say, the third one becomes more out-and-out slapstick. It tries to become more of a comedy, I think, than anything horror.
Yeah, sort of horror comedy, isn't it? Yeah,
action, horror comedy.
Well, I think they realised that's what this became a cult following. Whether they set out to make a serious, hardcore horror film, it ended up being embraced by the fans as kind of an over-the-top, sort of quite crazy thing. And so they pushed that a little bit more with the second, and with the third they knew what they were doing by then. And
it was a bit bizarre because they called it Bruce Campbell versus the Army.
Well, this is,
and he's the actor that plays Ash.
Yeah, and I think that's part of the reason. Bruce Campbell became a real cult
figure. But that's
bizarre. Well, it's not. If you again follow the journey and learn about the journey of the Evil Dead and the actor Bruce Campbell and the character he played, he became this sort of cult-followed character. Yeah, and that's what they can do. And this is because this is the director's cut official bootleg edition. So who knows what the original one? Maybe it's a different name for it. Army of Darkness is the actual film.
Yeah,
they've put Bruce Campbell on there because that sells this to the fans. And so they've put it versus.
Yeah, it didn't come out
as
cinema. It just came out as Army of Darkness.
Yeah, so they've put this on to package it up, and they've all done it like a fake. Look, it's even like a disc, look, like a sort of old DVD. Someone's just copied it and done it. I haven't copied this. This is a real shipped in from America.
But in that one, you can really see a lot of the influences. Gulliver's Travels, a bit where he gets pinned down by the
lots of little references,
lots of little hymns. He looks into the mirror. It's kind of he's in there, and the mirror gets smashed. And there's lots of little hymns running around. Yeah. That's quite a nice sequence, actually.
Yeah.
It becomes more fantasy for me because you've got the little things like that. They're meant to be like little imps or something. And then you. And then it suddenly dawned, it was like, oh, actually, this is more of a comic book. It had that comic book Pulp Fiction feel to it. And I think that really is then its strength. If you go in going, this is going to be kind of not trashy, and I don't mean that in a derogatory way, because it's a lot of fun, but it's just knowing what sort of film it is. You might enjoy it a bit better, I don't know.
Why is it, I mean... It's an interesting one, isn't it? If you're going to go and watch these films, I think you need to know what you're letting yourself in for. Because they are of their time. They are a journey of films.
Yeah.
And so that's the thing. But I embrace just getting a film and not knowing too much about it. I didn't know about these. And yeah. So just watching it and yeah, just opening yeah. my mind to just watching crazy. Yeah. It is, I think, what I got for this. These other influences, you said, it's very, very Jason the Argonauts, I think.
Jason the
really,
Argonauts,
I think
yeah.
Sam Raimi was very influenced by that. All the skeletons yeah. are directly from that. And
well, there was that.
And all the stop motion and Harryhausen type effects and stop motion stuff. And it's just
and
a real homage
that,
to that, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. And I think it is. And that one has a certain charm with that one, in the way that all the skeletons come alive as well. And also the, is it a Yankee, a Connecticut Yankee in New York?
Something
no, in
like
King Arthur's Court where like there's a modern person that was written
goes back in time
yeah,
to that, yeah.
but goes back in time, and that's a similar sort of influence. So there's that clash of his modern language and modern way of thinking with then the supposed medieval way of thinking. So he can come out with lines as yo she bitch,
yo she bitch.
Who needs anything more in a script?
You wouldn't stop speaking your own New York way just because you've gone back in time, would you?
Exactly.
So that was kind of the funny bits about it, I think.
There was a bit of a continuity. There seemed to be another continuity bit where, and this was to do with story, so this was a bit of a weird choice of story, where at the end of the second one, he goes back in time, and they got all these knights running around, and then this monster comes along, and he kind of shoots the monster, he's got his shotgun, he shoots this monster down, and they all go, oh, hail the new hero, hail the new hero, and you think, oh, okay, brilliant, he's a hero. Then the film ends, it picks up again, but it's when they've forgotten that he's done that, and then they sort of go, right, well, who are you, and you are the evil one that's come to kill us.
Again, right? There was probably several years, wasn't there, between making these films.
Yeah.
It wasn't like they back-to-back them like Back
no,
to the Future
that, well,
3
that
and
was,
4 or 2 and 3 or whatever it was, but they basically
well, it was
filmed 88 them at the same
and
time.
Then 93, but that's a story
you'd,
thing.
You'd look at that, but it wasn't film. Enough. For me, it was like that happened, and then this other guy trotted in, and he was the boss of these people, and he was suddenly like,
maybe
well, hang on,
like,
who
yeah,
are you?
Who are you?
So, but it was a little bit slightly.
It didn't explain.
We need to wrap this up. I'm so worried the camera's going
to
stop.
Okay.
And we're not going to know it's something. We're going to talk for another hour. We don't have time.
Tom and Jerry.
Tom and Terry.
Yeah.
Anyway,
thank you so much for watching.
Exactly. We put
hopefully,
1 minute. Say.
Hopefully you enjoyed that.
If you enjoy this kind of thing, watch them. Because first of all, that's
yeah.
a cult classic.
It is a
that's
classic.
A filmmaker's
film.
And a horror classic. So the other two is up to
you. Yeah, you can take away.
You know, if you've got a day to spare.
But it is interesting. I think if it is a trilogy, you should probably watch the trilogy because then you get the feel of all of it.
But it was never meant to be. So this
no.
is really a film stand on
yeah.
its own.
Yeah.
I think.
If you had 2 hours to watch it, it's an hour and a half.
Yeah.
Go for the first one.
Yeah, yeah.
If you've got a bit more time, check out the other two.
Do you like me showing Ken horror films that he doesn't like to watch? Because if you do, I've got a whole load to sit and make him watch. So
great.
Just write in the comments below or on the Facebook group.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes, we want more of you guys watching horror films.
Well, I think horror and sci-fi all overlaps
all
with fantasy, doesn't it?
Isn't it?
You've got
yeah.
these different strands.
Dipping in and out
different
of it now
strands.
And then.
Yeah definitely.
Yeah.
Cool. Until next time then.
Yes.
Remember.
Hopefully the camera's still rolling.
To keep it unreal. Especially when it's Halloween.